Hi, I'm Nick Parrish, and I'm one of the pharmacists on the UC Health transplant team, and we're going to review some information about the commonly prescribed medications following transplant. This video is meant to be a general guide. It is not all-inclusive. Additional information will be provided by the transplant team before you leave the hospital and within the written educational materials you receive. Be sure to always contact your transplant coordinator if you have any questions or concerns regarding your medications. This video will review the following information for the most common medications you will be taking post-transplant: the purpose, the usual dosage and dosage forms, the best way to take the medication, the most common side effects, and other important information. First, let's talk about medications within the first group, the immunosuppressant or anti-rejection medications. Tacrolimus is an anti-rejection medication, sometimes called by its brand name, Prograf. It is taken twice daily every 12 hours. It is important to take tacrolimus consistently, at the same time every day, to ensure a stable level of immunosuppression. It is best taken on an empty stomach, as foods can interfere with its effects. Your dosage will be determined by the level of tacrolimus in your blood and will change frequently. You'll be instructed to have blood tests done to measure the tacrolimus level in your blood. Blood levels are monitored in the morning and should be drawn within 1 hour before taking your dose. This is called a trough level and is the lowest level of tacrolimus that is present in the blood. So if you take your tacrolimus at 7 a.m. and 7 p.m., when should you have your blood test done? A, between 7 a.m. and 8 a.m. B, between 6 a.m. and 7 a.m. C, anytime. Or D, after the morning dose is taken. The blood test is to measure the trough, or lowest level in the blood. This should be done within 1 hour or less before taking your dose. So answer B is the best choice. On the days you are having blood tests done, you should not take tacrolimus until after your blood is drawn so an accurate trough level is obtained. Be sure to bring a dose with you to your laboratory appointment and take it right after your blood has been drawn. The most common side effects of tacrolimus vary and are usually related to the level of drug in the blood. They may include nervous system or neurotoxicities, such as headache, insomnia, or numbness and tingling of the hands and feet, kidney dysfunction or nephrotoxicity, infections, and there are other side effects for which you should refer to written information that will be provided to you. Mycophenolate, or CellCept, is another anti-rejection medication. It is usually taken twice a day and may be taken with or without food. Doses should be evenly spaced, taken 12 hours apart, and should not be taken at the same time as antacids in order to prevent rejection most effectively. As an example, you may wish to take mycophenolate after breakfast at 9 a.m. and then again at bedtime, 9 p.m. The most common side effects of mycophenolate include lowering the number of white blood cells in your body, nausea, stomach irritation, vomiting, or diarrhea, and it may cause birth defects, so birth control is required in females with reproductive potential. Prednisone is the third anti-rejection medication that most of our patients receive post-transplant. This medication is taken once daily and should be taken with food in order to prevent upset stomach. The dose of this medication is decreased or tapered over time. The length of time you will take this medication varies and may be from several days to several months, but is eventually discontinued in most patients. You should continue the same dosage until instructed by the transplant team to change your dose. Many of the side effects associated with prednisone happen with high dosages and long-term use. And since this medication is usually discontinued within a few months after transplant, you likely won't experience many of these effects. However, high blood sugars are common, and many patients will need to use insulin for at least the first several weeks following the transplant surgery to help control blood sugar levels. A diabetes educator may work with you after transplant while you are in the hospital so that you will be able to check your blood sugars at home and give yourself insulin if needed. You are probably wondering how you will be able to remember all of this information and be able to take your tacrolimus, mycophenolate, and prednisone correctly, right? You will use a medication instruction card and pill organizer. After you are transplanted, prior to being discharged from the hospital, A transplant pharmacist or other team members will work with you and your caregivers to fill out your medication card and pack your medications into a pill box. Caregivers should be aware that they should wear gloves when handling certain medications. Your pharmacist will discuss these concerns with you. Developing a comfortable schedule that works best with your daily routines will improve your success for taking all your medications at the right time every day. Let's practice now. The medication instruction card is organized with one medication listed in each row and with the medication strength, directions, and times of day you will take the medications listed within the columns. Usually, transplant patients have to take medications 4 or 5 times over the course of the day. Each medication, the dose, and how often you will take it each day, and the time you will need to take it will be written on the card. The card will then be used as a guide to pack your pill organizer. It is important to match the column headings on the card to the names of the squares on the pill organizer you will actually be using. For example, the first space on the card says before breakfast, while on the pill organizer, the first square says morn. The second space on the card says with or after breakfast, while on the pill organizer, the second square says noon. So you need to edit the card to match the pill organizer as you see here. You will see for this example, there are 5 sections on the medication card and only 4 boxes per day with this pill organizer. That is okay, we just need to adjust and make sure the card and the organizer match as you see here. For this example, let's say, based on your daily schedule, we determine that taking your 2 milligrams of tacrolimus at 7 a.m. and 7 p.m. is best. This would be written on the card as you see here, and then checks placed in the appropriate spaces. Mycophenolate must also be taken twice daily, every 12 hours, but many people prefer to take this medication with food. So for this example, we determine taking it at 9 a.m. and 9 p.m. is best. This would be written on the card as you see here, and then checks placed in the appropriate spaces, noon and bed. We then do the same for prednisone, which for this example you will take at 9 a.m., which is the second box on the pill organizer labeled noon. Once the information is complete for each of the medications you are prescribed, we will use this card to fill your weekly pill organizer. So let's get started and actually fill the pill box with your tacrolimus medication. Remember, for this medication, your dosage is determined by your blood level. Let's say you are to take 2 milligrams at 7 a.m. and 2 milligrams at 7 p.m. This would be indicated with a check mark on your card, as you see here. The capsules supplied by the pharmacy are 1 milligram in strength. Thus, to get a 2 milligram dose, you will need to take 2 capsules each time. So you would remove 2 capsules from the bottle and place in the square from Monday morn, Monday eve, Tuesday morn, and eve, and so forth until the entire week is filled. Let's try another one, mycophenolate. If your dose is 500 milligrams twice daily at 9 a.m. and 9 p.m., the capsules supplied by the pharmacy are 250 milligrams strength. Thus, to get a 500 milligram dose, you will need to take 2 capsules each time. So you would remove 2 capsules from the bottle and place them in the squares corresponding to Monday 9 a.m., Monday at 9 p.m., which would be Monday noon and bed. For Tuesday at 9 a.m. and 9 p.m., it would be Tuesday noon and Tuesday bed, and so forth until the entire week is filled. You will repeat these steps for each medication. Plan to spend 30 minutes to an hour each week updating your medication card and filling your pill box. The medication card and pill organizer go hand in hand to provide a system that allows you to take your medications correctly and consistently. Now let's review the anti-infective medications. You will take these medications to prevent infections in the first several months after your transplant, when infections are the most likely to occur. The length of time for each medication is different for each patient depending on certain risk factors. Bactrim is used to prevent bacterial infections. Your prescription may be labeled by its generic name, sulfamethoxazole trimethoprim, or an abbreviation such as SMZ-TMP. The strength of the tablet is 400/80, or SS for single strength. Bactrim may be taken with or without food, but should be taken with plenty of water. Side effects are not common, but let the transplant team know immediately if you develop a rash, hives, or itching. Patients with allergies to sulfa medications will be given a different antibiotic. Valganciclovir, or Valcyte, is used to prevent viral infections. Some patients will receive other antiviral medications, such as acyclovir or valacyclovir. Valganciclovir is best taken with food. Both Bactrim and Valcyte may lower your blood cell counts or cause an increase in liver or kidney function tests in some patients. It is important to take exactly as instructed and to obtain routine laboratory tests so we can monitor for these effects. Fluconazole is used to prevent fungal infections. It is a tablet that is taken once daily with or without food. Most people do not experience side effects from this medication. Rarely, this drug can lead to liver damage. However, we will closely watch your lab work in order to prevent this from occurring. Nystatin is used instead of fluconazole in certain patients to prevent fungal infection of the mouth and throat, called thrush. Nystatin comes in a liquid that is swished in the mouth and swallowed 3 times daily. You should shake the bottle well before measuring out each dose, and make sure not to eat or drink within 30 minutes afterwards so the medication is not washed away. The anti-infectives will also be added to your medication card and pill organizer. For this example, Bactrim is taken as one tablet once daily at 9 a.m. It would be added to the medication card like this, and you would insert one tablet into the appropriate section of the pill box, which would be noon for this example, for each day. As you can see, the square we are placing the Bactrim in also contains the mycophenolate. This is common. So to help prevent confusion or mistakes, it's important to fill the pill organizer with one medication at a time for the entire week before starting on another medication. So after you have finished the Bactrim, you would next do valganciclovir, or Valcyte. And then for this example, you were prescribed nystatin as your antifungal medication. Remember that this is taken 3 times a day, but because it is a liquid, it does not go into the pill organizer. Now we will review some of the other medications transplant recipients are usually taking. Gastrointestinal agents include several medications that suppress stomach acid, so that you are less likely to have side effects like stomach pain or ulcers. The medication prescribed typically depends on insurance coverage, as these medications are all similar in how well they work. Instructions may differ depending on the medication used, but they are generally taken in the morning before breakfast. These medications are usually temporary and may be stopped in most patients after several months. Side effects are not common, but may include nausea, diarrhea, and headache. These medications are also added to your medication card and are usually the only other medications taken in the morning with the morning dose of tacrolimus. Insulin therapy is used in many patients to control blood sugar levels, which are increased following transplant, usually due to the effects of certain medications. Insulin is given by injections under the skin, often several times a day. If we would like you to use insulin at home, we will arrange for a certified diabetes educator to meet with you and your caregivers while you are in the hospital. The educator will review with you how to check blood sugars and perform insulin injections. Some patients will not need insulin, but will be asked to check blood sugars regularly. We will make sure that you have a blood glucose meter and are instructed on how to use it before you leave the hospital. We realize that checking your own blood sugars and giving insulin injections can be difficult, but it is very important to do in order to prevent complications and potential admissions back to the hospital. We will work with you in order to become more comfortable with this therapy prior to your discharge from the hospital. Pain management is also very important after transplant. Everyone's response to pain is different, and we will work with you in the hospital to find a medication that works well for you. You will be given a prescription for pain medication when you leave the hospital that you can take as needed for pain. Pain should gradually improve over time post-transplant, allowing you to decrease the amount and then stop taking the medication as tolerated. If pain becomes more intense after you leave the hospital, you should contact your transplant coordinator. As pain medications can cause constipation, you should be sure to drink plenty of fluids and take stool softeners or laxatives as directed. Since taken on an as-needed basis, we recommend that you do not put these pills into your pill organizer. Additional medications may be needed depending on the patient. They may include things like blood pressure medications and medications to prevent bone loss. For example, patients taking prednisone may be asked to take supplemental calcium and vitamin D. Since good nutrition is so important in your recovery, we may also ask you to take a daily multivitamin. Your transplant team will assess you for these needs and arrange for you to have these medications if needed. All of these other medications will also be added to the back side of your medication card and to your pill organizer. A few medications may not be able to be stored in the pill organizer, such as insulin, so we will work with you to develop a system for taking any medications not kept within the pill organizer. There are a few other key points about your transplant medications I'd like to review. Always use your medication card. Always refer to your medication card for instructions on taking your medications rather than the label on the bottle. Always keep a copy of your medication card with you. Always take your medications as scheduled. Use a weekly pill organizer. Do not stop taking or change the way you are taking your medications without discussing with the transplant team. Contact your transplant coordinator with any medication-related questions. As you can see, there are many medications that are needed following your transplant. Many of these are temporary, while others are to be taken for the rest of your life. Successful outcomes post-transplant depend on these medications and you taking them as instructed by your transplant team. Transplant pharmacists and nurses will work with you and your caregivers to learn about these medications while you are in the hospital. You need to make sure that you understand how to take them all correctly before you go home. Thank you.